public comments?
No, I'm good, thanks.
Okay, all right, well, we will move on then to a finance and operations update for June.
So we held our board finance committee yesterday morning. The president was there, so she's gonna check to make sure I share the exact same stuff that we talked about yesterday, but so we had a couple of discussion items, we talked through our monthly financial statements through the month of February. I gave a very brief bond construction update, a lot has changed from what we've been seeing, we have a big phase change over here coming up in spring break. And then we have several action items that you'll see at Monday's meeting for consideration, so three are related to technology. The first one is a rather large device purchase, so, you know, we have our inventory of our devices, and we have our Chromebooks that are on a five-year replacement cycle. So we have, we're recommending to replace 3,747 Chromebooks. And we would purchase those from People Journey Technology at a cost not to exceed $1,450,089. And we're utilizing the Midwestern Higher Education Compact, so People Journey Technology has that contract through them. And it would be funded in a combination with our 2021 Capital Projects Fund, as well as our ESSER II equalization. You will also see a request to replace 36 iMacs, so 12 at each of our high schools. These iMacs are housed in a broadcasting and theater program, so they too are at the end of their life cycle. And in addition to the iMac computers, we would purchase the Final Cut software. Both of those would be through Apple at their Apple Education pricing. And that's at a cost of $101,088. And that would be funded by our general fund for the software and our 2021 capital projects for the actual iMacs. And then our last technology recommendation would be to approve the third year of our three-year agreement for our Microsoft suite of products through CDWG. So the amount hasn't changed, it's $43,047, and that is funded by our general fund. Then we will have a recommendation to purchase some of our updates to classroom furniture from VS America for an amount not to exceed $313,000. Also funded by our 2021 Capital Project Fund. And this first round of furniture replacement is focusing in on our classrooms that are seeing the renovation. So we're looking at Collins, Fletcher View, Vernon Eastern, and Northern High. This particular item is strictly chairs. We're still vetting the teacher selections. We went through the open house kind of in December, beginning part of January. And so our interior designers or their architect firms are vetting their selections, making sure they still fit. They fit in the classroom and it's within the budget that they've allocated. So we hope to have another recommendation, a much wider recommendation that our people need for you to consider. We also took some time to go through a bunch of that. So I gave you a packet of information. I just want to highlight a few things because it's some big changes, and we're gonna talk through what those major changes are related to our general fund. So if you go back to page 3, you can see in the last two columns is what we're going to focus on. The 2021-22 budget column is the budget that you adopted back in June of 2021. So our total revenues at that point were, we anticipate them to be at $111 million, a little over $111 million. And then you can see what we're proposing for this budget amendment in that final column is revenue coming in at $119.6 million. And that's comprised of a variety of different changes. So on the local side, we have just three that we wanted to highlight. Our Medicaid fee for service, we're anticipating that being up by about $200,000. Our sale of capital assets, we know because we held that auction and you know, those other sales over the summer, that's an increase of $125,000. And then a one-time insurance refund, that's about $780,000. And that's related to the change in our workers' comp program that we're participating in. So again, that's a one-time refund for that participation. We don't expect that to continue moving forward. On the state side, we have several changes. There's a new categorical related to special education, so that's bringing in about $293,000. There's also an increase to our special education heavy obligation by the state, and that's $385,000. And then there's two that are related to our participation in the retirement program or MIXERS. One is 147A, so that's kind of to help offset the cost of retirement and the increases. That one actually went down about $237,000. And then we have our 147C, and that's a little over $1.8 million. And the 147C is the one that's related to the state capped years ago, back when the reform happened, and Kristen, you probably remember that, because you had to make an election as a school employee yourself. The state capped what the district's obligation was, and then that left an unfunded portion. But they can't pay that directly from the state's budget to pay that liability off. So what they have to do, they have to pass it through the school district. So that's what this is. It's really an in and out. We get the revenue in, and then they invoice us, and we pay them the money back directly. So again, that's a little over $1.8 million. We're also reflecting in this amendment our ESSER II money, so our formula and our equalization. So our ESSER II formula is about $883,000, so all of that is budgeted in this. And our ESSER II equalization is a little over $3 million, but we're just budgeting a little over $2 million in this amendment. We don't anticipate spending that full equalization by the end of June. And we have until September of 2023 to spend both of those two buckets of money anyway. Some of the additional revenue changes related to going from $111 to $119 million are our grants, about $1.6 million. And those do not impact the bottom line. Revenue is always match expenditures related to our grants. And then because we have a multitude of account numbers, we have a miscellaneous changes, ups and downs, that total about $248,000. So those are our revenue changes. And then if you look at our expenditure bottom line, what you adopted back in June was a little over $116 million in expenditures. And we're, our amendment, we're proposing a little over $125 million. And so we just have a few things to highlight on the expenditure side as well. Back in December, the board approved off-schedule payment to all of our employees, and that totaled about $1.5 million. We know our tuition for our virtual students went up about $355,000. We're also reflecting the contracts for our special education itinerants. We just didn't capture that when we adopted the budget back in June, even though their contracts were settled. So we're capturing that in this amendment, that's about $191,000. Our operations team has been busy maintaining and repairing various things throughout the district, so we need to up that budget a little bit by about $237,000. We have the counterpart of expenditures for that 147C that we just talked about, so that's the $1.8 million. Our ESSER II formula and equalization, the 3.1, again, it's a match, revenue and expense, same with the 1.67 for other grant charges. We have our communications department, an increase of $145,000. And last but not least, we have the miscellaneous changes of about $75,000. So that's what's going on with our general fund. And then if you look on this page, you can see kind of the impact to our fund balance. So when you adopted the budget back in June, we anticipated using about $5.1 million of fund balance. And that was really intentional, right? We settled employee contracts. The fund balance had been going up, and so that was something that you as a board were interested in doing. So that is the bulk of that use. With this amendment, we're reflecting using $5.7 million. But keep in mind, that would be if we spent every single dollar, right, on our expenditure side, and we typically don't do that. Dan was pretty close when he was guessing about a 2% variance on our expenditure side, and our 10-year average is about 1.9%. So. It was a very educated, yes, I think I've shown that in the past, in our planning of the year, so, so we won't, you know, we won't end up using the $5.7 million, but, you know, that's what we're projecting right now. We also have some changes to our school service fund, and again, that fund is comprised of three different smaller funds. That's our food service program, our childcare program, and our student and school activity fund. And some big highlights for that on the revenue side, it's going up about $1.6 million. And the bulk of that is with some increase in federal funding. So I know a few meetings ago, I think Christine mentioned, we have a childcare sustainability grant, a little over $900,000, so we're reflecting that in this amendment. And we know this year the food service program is offering free meals, which is at a higher reimbursement rate. We were anticipating that when we adopted the budget back in June, so we're collecting that as well as a supply chain grant that the district was awarded, and that was about $167,000.
So remind me about the child care grant. I know I remember the supply chain, but remind me about the child care one.
It's a grant that is given out per building that's running a child care program. Mm-hmm. And the intent was just to support the child care programs across the state who struggled during COVID and perhaps needed additional funds. Mm-hmm. And so they went back and just based on the enrollment in our programs, a certain amount was allocated.
Okay.
I mean, total about $900,000.
Okay.
And on the expenditure side, you see the slight uptick in expenditures, about $1 million. That's really related to the supply chain grant, as an area of revenue expense. We're seeing some increased food costs, and we have a slight uptick in our wages and our benefits related to food service. And then also in the food service area, we have an increase in our equipment costs. So we've talked before, actually, probably back in October when we presented the audit, that our food service program fund balance has grown, and there is a cap on how much we can have in fund balance for that program. If we're limited to 3 months of operating expense, and so we're starting to try to spend that money down for the state. We have to turn in a plan. We've done that. The plan is approved. It's really all in equipment, so we're reflecting some of the cost increase related to that. So those are the big highlights for the budget amendment that we're asking you to approve on Monday. Certainly we have historical data in here we've always provided, so you can see year over year where we've been. So if you've got questions on the budget amendment before Monday's meeting, please feel free to reach out. And then we have one last action item. We do have a couple property tax refunds, one to Kent County, a little over $30,000, and one to the city of Grand Rapids.
Just to explain more on those property tax refunds, because we never know when they're going to come in. These are typically the result of a property owner, could be residential, could be commercial property, whatever, appealing the valuation of the property. And sometimes those appeals wind their way through a long process. It can take some years. It may even go up with the Michigan Tax Tribunal. They'll issue a ruling on the valuation. And if the ruling changes, sometimes there'll be refunded taxes that have been paid in previous years that are paid back. Since by constitution, we're recipient of a portion of property taxes, both on the homestead side and the non-homestead, really is what we're talking about, that come directly to school districts. We would then refund those back. But again, as the foundation allowance is really a combination of two things. It's the amount of money we raise locally, and then whatever additional amount the state needs to kick in to achieve that per pupil amount that the legislature sets. So if we reduce, in this case, because we're refunding a little bit back to a property owner, the amount of local share paid by the non-homestead tax, the state makes that up by increasing, even retroactively in the cases of a tax tribunal decision, the state share, so that it still comes back to that statutorily set per pupil amount of funding, if that makes sense. So we see those come through, and it just requires action on our part to approve those repayments in that regard, that other taxing jurisdictions and authorities have made around valuation. We don't get involved with valuation.
Action items related to the purchases that you've got questions on. How many Chromebooks did you say?
Chromebooks?
Yeah.
3,747. Not 3,750, I already asked. We'll be looking for every secure nook cranny in this building to hold them and get them ready so that we can get them up to school. And we're hoping we get them in so we have time to make all those things that get them ready. Like they come in, it's not like we can just pull out a box and distribute them. So there's some work that we do to them. So hoping they come in time so we can get everything in place for school to start football.
Yeah.
This is a little bit off topic. Have we heard? Are we having food paid for again next fall?
I've not seen anything in the federal budget for that, so I don't think so, but it's a good question. The federal budget is always like months behind on where we're supposed to be. They always do continuing resolutions to kick the can down the road, but I've not heard anything.
I have one more, which I know is everyone's favorite topic. Have we made any progress or any more conversations about some solutions for parents with busing? I know we talked last time about before and after school.
Yeah.
Idea. Yeah. I still have not thought of my
career. Your name.
Your
bus.
Oh, is that what you?
That's what I thought I called it too. But you didn't. You thought it was better than that.
Yeah, I did.
Now
he doesn't like it.
Yeah, I know Scott. We were going to talk. Scott, obviously, Scott and I had like talked. Mm-hmm. We were going to follow up with the elementary principals to see what are some options in the building and maybe flex some schedules or how we can handle that. And we just haven't connected.
The model's coming up. We haven't had that yet. So
okay.
We will talk about it.
Okay. Principals. Okay. So can we revisit this then in April?
Yeah.
And hear what you guys talked about?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
We'll definitely put it on as a discussion item for finance, and then that will be that'll trigger to bring that to you.
Okay.
Thank you, Julie. Next, moving into the instruction portion of the agenda, glad to have John here. John Mr. Hogan is the principal at Central Middle School, and he is here to talk about Easter.
So welcome, and thank you guys. My name is John Hager, the principal of Central Middle School. We've not met. I'm excited to be here to talk about our ACE period. And our ACE period is our intervention block that we have at Central Middle School. It's a 25-minute period that we have every single day. Currently in our schedule, it's housed in 3B, which is that little bit of time right after third period, right before fourth period. Our eighth graders are going to lunch after, so they're excited about that. But today I wanted to talk about where we were at the beginning of the year, where we're at now, and our vision for the future for finding ways to support all students at Central Middle School. So as you see up there, we have a simple saying, every student, every day, whatever it takes at Central Middle School, and I know all buildings, of course, those believe that too. We just coined the slogan first. But as we go through this, my hope is that you see that throughout the presentation, throughout the work that we're doing, we aim to be strategic, intentional, and supportive for all students. So we go to the next slide now. So as I look back, when I first got there in the fall, our primary interventions for all students were assigned sustained reading, study table, and then bottom 30 intervention. Those three things alone, they have some merit behind them. There are some strategies within them that we can do to support students. But does that reach the vision of supporting every student every day? And I'm not the kind of leader that would just come in and blanket change everything. So we spent the first few months as a staff doing some learning around the current interventions we have in place at Central Middle School? What do we do in our everyday classrooms? What staff do we have to support? What programs do we have to support, whether it be the learning loss of our students or the advanced abilities of our students? Because intervention isn't just for the low students, it's for all students. And as we did that learning, we found out one simple answer: no, we weren't doing what's best for our students, for all students. And so we had to make some shifts. ACE, by the way, stands for All Classrooms Excel. It took me a couple months to learn that, but we're there now. So we go to the next slide, we'll talk about where we're currently at. So working with the teachers, working with the counselors, we identified areas of needs for our students. And one of the big ones is being 2 years kind of removed from a typical school year, there was a lack of executive functioning skills. You know, we have Canvas now, why not learn how to use it the best way possible? We have PowerSchool. Our 7th and 8th graders can look up their own grades, identify what topics they have to work on in class. So Monday is a primary day where our students have an opportunity to look at all the work that they have ahead of them, work maybe they have to make up, and how we can support them. Locker clean out, backpack organization, all the fun stuff they need to be successful for the rest of the week. So that's our primary goal on Monday. Tuesday we move to IXL, so our math teachers use it in their core classrooms, but they also assign every student certain skills based on where they're at. Right? IXL is an intervention program that allows students to, or allow our teachers to identify where students need support. Again, bottom 30, top 30, everywhere in the middle, there's skills that support our students. On Wednesday, we still find value in sustained reading. That is an important thing. To be a better reader, we have to read. Right? It's pretty simple. So students, depending on where they're at in their curriculum, read for joy. Right? They have the ability to go to the media center, or they read within their book clubs if they might need to catch up a little bit as a team. Thursday, our ELA teachers have the opportunity to identify where in the curriculum they are. If they're in a writing unit and they need to work on a specific grammar skill because they notice that these middle schoolers aren't punctuating where they need to be, or they're working on this. They assign every single middle schooler that grammar skill usually and have that ability to add that little lesson in there so that it's front loaded and students know what they're talking about when they get to class. And then finally, where would we be without a positive school culture? And so on Fridays, usually it's an opportunity for all of our houses, because if you don't know, we're in a house system, to get together and have a little bit of fun together, learn and grow, and just be part of the team together. So next few slides, I have some examples from our 8th grade White House, and this is what they present to kids. So when kids walk in the room, this is the work they're going to be doing. So this is from last week. So on Monday, here is their executive functioning day. Again, these are middle schoolers. They all have the ability to kind of work on their own with a lot of this stuff. And so you'll see right there, it tells them what materials they need to be successful, and then these are the things they should be checking. And obviously, this isn't, you're in a classroom by yourself. There's a teacher there. Every ACE teacher has a select group of students that they're with all year long. And so they go through each one of these to make sure they're ready for the week. Moving forward to Tuesday, this last Tuesday we happened to have an assembly where the high school counselors and administrators were coming in, so the schedule's a little bit wonky. But I figured I'd still show you, because even though schedules get mixed up, we still move forward with what we're doing. So create a good first impression for Mr. Passanow. They did that. And then moving on to Wednesday, so we kind of just pushed everything back. So this is our math IXL day. You'll see it tells them what materials they need. If you have algebra, it's already starred for them. So students know if I'm with Ms. Gallard in algebra, I'm gonna log into IXL and those stars right there in my name are the ones I need to work on. Otherwise, math 8 teachers have agreed we need to work on this because this is the lessons we're working on in class. So every single student has a targeted intervention that supports the learning they're doing when we work on IXL. If students finish the task, they can always go back to classwork, homework, or independently read. And we'll say most times they are working up through the 25-minute period. 25 minutes goes pretty fast when you account for everything. So moving forward, So IXL is a program that I know we fund at Central Middle School. I just like to share in the celebration of it. Our students have already answered, if I were to update this, probably closer to 500,000 questions since the beginning of the year, in that 7th and 8th grade. Our students are using it, our teachers are loving it, we're seeing great gains in it in both math and ELA. If you break it down, it's pretty much 200,000, 250,000 math in ELA. So our students are using it, our students are growing in it, we're seeing gains in our math scores from it. So there's a little hesitation at first because it is a program for students. Some of them harp against it, some of them still harp against it, but the 13, 14 year So moving forward, we'll keep it going. Thursdays are IXL ELA day, so again, these are just examples of what students see, says what they need, says what they're working on. This is an eighth grade example. So each house provides these slides for their students as well. Then go to Friday, we're doing a free throw shooting competition because it's March Madness. So each house rented out the gym and they had competitions. The winner got, I think it was candy or free homework pass, depending on the house. At the beginning of the year, we provided each house a little bit of culture cash to support their students' engagement and everything. So they had a really good time. The students really enjoy that Friday. It's a little reward for the end, but it also builds teamwork and camaraderie. And then I just wanted to throw in what a Wednesday one would look like for silent reading. Read. It's that simple, right? You can either read your dystopian novels, which is what they're currently working on in eighth grade, their dystopian book clubs, or then they go to the media center, because we have a big, beautiful media center that has a lot of great books for them to read. So that's where we're currently at. Now I want to quickly touch base as to what hopefully it looks like moving forward, a true advisory period, working with our counselors, working with our teachers, all to be intentional, strategic, and support every student, right? Our idea of what ACE is going to turn into is a program that supports students in building positive relationships with teachers, their peers, and academics, right? Providing a safe place for students to strengthen their academic and social needs and encourage communication and advocacy. One thing we talk about a lot with our students at Central Middle School is if you have an issue, you need to go to your teacher. A lot of times they'll come to me or parents will come to me and we say, have you emailed your teacher yet? Really making sure they understand you have every tool to be successful in front of you. We need to understand how to use it. So we're toying with ideas of, do we move ACE from third period to first period so we can have more opportunities for an extended learning if students come in early? We are toying with a lot of different ideas to support students. We feel we've already made great gains from where we were at in the fall to where we're currently at now. So that is our intervention block in a quick snapshot. Thank you for having me. Does anybody have any questions?
Is this the first year your kids have been exposed to IXL? Is that why they're not loving it?
So, they did IXL at CW.
Okay.
IXL is a program where all the research says that 80% proficient means that you have used IXL.
Yeah.
So 80% proficient means that you're good to go. And when you hit 80% in IXL, you get the challenge zone. Ooh. But as soon as you hit that challenge zone, if you get one wrong, you go backwards.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right? And so at Central Middle, 80% is where we kind of stop. If students would like to continue on and hit that challenge zone, they can. In the past, that message wasn't always there. And some students got real frustrated that they couldn't get to 100%. So we made it very clear and strategic at the beginning that we're 80% is where we need to be in order to move to our next topic. And so we're past that now. Now it's just a matter of students that some enjoy it greatly and do it at home, and some we still need to talk to a little bit.
Do you have a house winner at the end of the year?
For IXL?
No, just in general.
Oh.
No.
It depends on the competition.
Yeah.
I think every house is a winner. We are starting. We are starting construction soon, and we'll get some flags. You know, that's a 3-year project. I think we can come back to you. Yeah.
That's cool.
Thank you, John.
Thank you guys for having me.
I just really like the idea of adding some flexibility, because we know with some students they just need a little bit more time with the concept. And if the concept was introduced yesterday, to have that ACE period the next morning on that intervention period, that can close that gap. And we know that makes all the difference in the world. So, and also with extensions for kids that say, hey, I got it. I'm ready to move forward on that to be able to engage those students well. So thanks for stopping that discussion.
So that just kind of reminded me of a question. Let's say you have a kid who is so type A and they are so organized. So on Mondays when you have your executive function day, is there something else that they get to do or can do?
Help your messy friend?
That's always an option. So that's what is flexibility for each teacher. So every teacher knows their students. We have house meetings twice a month.
Mm-hmm.
And so we discuss every single student, those house meetings within the house. So our counselors and administrators, either we each pick one house to go to and we rotate, so that way we all have a good idea of what's going on. So if there's a student that's twice exceptional in our building, which we're very fortunate to have some students that are that way, they still have activities to do. And most times, you know, I'll say maybe one or two of our 13, 14-year-olds are so on top of their organization and academics and Canvas and Power School that they don't have anything to do, in which case, Ms. Berger and the Media Center usually is there to help them, or they're able to help a friend, or, you know, there's always an extension somewhere.
Yeah.
We just need to work to find it.
So John, right now, I get to hear from Central Middle School mm-hmm. students and Northern Hills Middle School students as well, given that my son is this age group. But I'm extra curious about it because at my school, we've just started a sort of advisory block, and right now it's
yeah.
But what I hear from the kids when I ask questions is that they are actually making use of this time, that they are getting something from it, that they middlingly enjoy it, be realistic, because of course it's stuff to do. But I've got to say that I love hearing the success from the kids' mouths about that, because I can compare it to the baby version that we are sort of starting
right.
in my own district and seeing what that can become when it's done well. So I know that you're doing it well.
Mm-hmm.
I know that it's being done well at Northern as well.
Yeah.
I don't know any Eastern kids, so
yeah.
That's fine.
Well, thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks, Sam.
Enjoy the weather.
Yep.
Yeah.
Take care.
Thank you.
Up next, Tamasha with the Educational Equity and Inclusion Update.
Good afternoon. I am really excited. I have been invited / summoned to meeting with high school students. Our student advisory council that meets with Dan so often has kind of said, hey, my new person to the district, can we chat? So before spring break, I'll have the opportunity to meet with students from each of the high schools and to hear their thoughts, ideas, feedback surrounding DEI work as they see it in the district. As equity work continues, student voice is a high leverage strategy when we talk about, obviously, about getting what we need to our students. So really excited to hear what they have to say, honor their voices, but really important to begin to embed that ongoing conversation with me and those students over the course of the year. So listening to them about how they want that, what they want to say, how they see that, maybe talking about how we do things, but that is coming before spring break. So look forward to giving you kind of what their thoughts were at our next meeting in April. That's a big thing on the horizon. Student voice, loading.
Up next, I'm going to skip down to the review of the textbook recommendations with Chris. I'll put that up on the up here on the board, because we do have a whole host of recommendations to share with you.
Yeah. Well, thank you guys for having me here to present some recommendations for our high school, for our high school courses, for new curricular resources for next year. Our high school teachers have worked really hard over the last 2 years to even look at some of these resources to really find something that best supports our instructional practices and then supports our students as well. So before we go into it, I just wanted to give you a little perspective of what goes into these curricular review meetings and how we get to the point of coming up with a recommendation. So in the meetings, we have a select group of teachers come in, usually from different levels or different content areas, and we have them look at standards and go through some activities with standards that will align with our resources. And then we talk about our different links of learning and what makes an ideal resource, what are we looking for from an ideal resource before we start looking at them. And then we talk about the essential best practices for instruction. That there's a document from the NDE that are research-based practices to support learning. So we have the teachers look through those best practices as well. We have some discussions around that. And then we had rubrics for each one. So there's four science courses and then one of the social studies courses. And we have rubrics for separately for those two. So I do have an example of that if you'd like to see it for social studies. And then we invited the reps in to come do a presentation and talk to our teachers, give them a demo of what it looks like online and talk about the different components of the resources. And then we gave them February to just look through it. They had an opportunity to pilot a lesson if they chose to. We didn't require it this time. We probably will in the future, but they had that option to do that. So, and then we came back after February, we just had a discussion of which resource best fit all of those needs. So, there are four that we are going to talk about today. I'm going to stop in between each one and just pause and go over any questions that you might have regarding each of them. So we don't have to wait until the very end. So the first one is environmental science. This is a new course that's going to be implemented next school year. As you know, the high school science teachers have worked for a couple of years to really support their next generation science standards and making sure that their courses are aligned to those standards. So they have revamped what the course sequence looks like in the high school level. So this is the last one in that sequence, the environmental science. So there was not a textbook that we had looked at prior to this. After going through that curricular review process, they recommend that for science, the 15th edition. The reason why they like that resource is the text was really engaging. It really supported student learning. It had QR codes for tutorials. There was a section that is like a data analysis and check for understandings throughout the entire text. The online platform, it has a mobile field trip feature to it, so they didn't have to go anywhere for a field trip, which would be nice in the last couple of years, but that's something that they can just do on a daily basis, is they can do those field trips. It has activity-based learning throughout the entire platform that they can incorporate into the classroom. Pretty standard now are the e-texts on the online platform. Students can highlight on the e-book, they can take notes on the book, they can review different vocabulary terms, and that's become pretty standard on all of these online platforms for all the different companies. But what's nice about this one is that students can download it to their phone. There's an app for a mobile app, so they don't need to be online in order to have access to that textbook. They can be completely offline, which is really nice for this publisher. So you see there's two separate ones. So the top one, the Earth Science, the recommendation would be to get a classroom set of those textbooks along with digital access for students and teachers. And then the bottom one is just a supplemental resource that teachers are just recommending they have teachers only have digital access just to that portion of it. The reason being is that they plan to use that resource to pull data from, to pull labs from. Case studies are all on that digital platform that teachers can use to help support the student learning. And it also scaffolds some lessons and give them some differentiated options as well for students that may need some more support and then students that may need some more enrichment. Any questions on the environmental?
I did have a question. First, a question I had was, I think you said it was a two-year process to go through reviewing these textbooks. Is that because COVID hit in the middle of what was probably already started?
I believe that was part of it. I think also they were just going through that process of revamping the sequence, and so as they were going through looking at resources for all of them, they also looked at environmental one way.
All right, so I'm guessing like you may have had like a whole day meeting or something to review the standards, the first one,
yeah.
And step two, another day for looking at the rubrics.
Oh, yeah.
So it wasn't like packed into 1 week.
Oh,
it's an extended program. Okay.
Yeah.
So then, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, in fact, since we've known this has been coming for so long,
mm-hmm.
The environmental science team has even spent longer on it because we've known this course has been coming for some time.
Mm-hmm.
So some of the work they did prior to this is Chris's first year coming into the position is work with Jim Durkee.
Well, then my other question is, it's from 2018. There's no more updated versions of this?
This is the one that they selected. Now, the one thing the publishers will do, which we constantly check, so if they have, you'll see this will happen with another book that we're going to present. If there's a more recent updated version of this textbook, sometimes we'll swap them out.
Mm-hmm.
And then any updates they do, one great thing about having digital access is that we can get instant
do the students therefore use the online version more often so they have the more updated information than they do the physical textbooks?
We see that, yes.
Okay. We still like to have physical textbooks mm-hmm. because some students prefer it and some students need it, but the majority of teachers and students are leaning heavily on the online platform.
Okay, because I noticed your list there, and we've got 2018, 2019, 2017 for text, and I thought that was really interesting. Perhaps there isn't anything new, or if it's being used more heavily digitally, then I can see that being, you know, just fine.
Right.
But okay.
So, if they update the digital access on a regular basis, how different then are the classroom copies from what the kids are going to use?
Usually what we see is not that different. If it's the same exact version, it's just updated. So they really don't notice a lot of difference. We have one that is, I don't know if we're presenting it today or next time, there's so many textbooks right now.
Yeah.
But we have one where we already know. We have a 2017 that the teachers really know. We already know down the road the publisher is afraid of telling us, hey, like in a year we know we're going to update. It's just not yet. Mm-hmm. And so they'll even tell us, like, hey, in a year we'll send you the new books. You send us the books back. Mm-hmm. And then the difference is very, it's not as
much. It's minimal.
If it's the same book.
Why would they do that?
I mean, what benefit is that to the company? I'm curious.
To send you.
I used to be a textbook
searcher.
Yes. Yes. Because you can sell them books.
But I'm saying, if you're just going to pass it on, I mean, it sounded to me like we're just going to give you the updated version, but they can charge for the updated version.
Or if they send us the books.
Right, the physical books.
No, normally if we're working on a deal, we would say just a swap, an even swap. So they know if something's coming, right, they would say, yes, we know you want this resource. And then they already know that you're down the road, that we have one that we're working with that will just swap it.
Because they'd rather have you as a customer.
They want us as a competition.
To me, yes.
All right.
Right. If you, because then you become loyal to
them. Yeah,
loyal.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah. Yeah, so they are not for that particular one. It's not in this case. But then we always ask if,
right.
Even if it were 2021, one of our standard questions when we have a rep is, if when you update this edition, will we have access? Some will say no, but most will say yes. We will give you, as we update, you can have the latest version.
Because sometimes if it's like a major overhaul,
yes.
Or a read, you know, because I used to sell physics book, but then, you know, you're on the version 11, or, you know, 11, whatever, and then 12 is
it.
I did a lot of things in my life.
Yeah,
so
that's
useful information.
Useful information, yes.
I was a young woman, yes, back in the day, yes.
Some will do an overhaul. Yeah. And we have some middle school social studies that's coming out that with TCI where it's an overhaul. Mm-hmm. The teachers went through a review process, but that's for another time. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Any
the next one is advanced geology. So advanced geology is only taught at Central High School. It's a course specific for that high school. They currently do not have a textbook. Teachers have been pulling in resources from different places and pulling their own thing together based on the standards. But however, they would like to have something that would be more consistent for teachers and for students to use. So their recommendation would be the Essentials of Geology, which is the 13th edition of 2018. This is by the same publisher as the environmental. So the online platform is pretty similar to what the online platform was for the environmental science. The nice thing about this one for the text, they have a lot of like, did you know facts throughout the entire text? So it kind of just sparks student interest as they're reading. And makes them want to learn maybe just a little bit more and take it a step further. So I thought that was a really cool part of it. And they also have the QR codes that are throughout the book that gives them a tutorial on whatever concept they may be talking about, to either for enrichment or for support. Like I said, the online, it has the mobile field trips. It's called Mastering Geology, which is like an online homework. It's tutorials. It's assessments. It's very interactive. They have self-paced tutorials to go along with each of the lessons as well, which is really nice.
but really provide a wide range of just activities to kind of hit all of those student needs throughout the online platform and in the book. So the recommendation would be just a classroom set of the geology books at Central and then digital access for students and teachers.
Okay, another question. So I'm curious about your process here. Was it the teachers who requested that we look into a textbook for this, or was this like an administrative recommendation?
Yeah, it was a teacher that, there's one teacher at Central that teaches it, and he recommended that we go through the process to review it. And then the next one is college physics. It's AP physics. This is for AP physics 1 and 2. This is taught only at Northern High School. Eastern and Central have AP physics C. So this was actually just one teacher that I worked with, but we went through the same process, same curricular review process of looking at standards and really having a rubric and going through the same protocols that we went through if it were a large curricular review. So prior to the review, they used the same name. It's called College Physics, but it's by Pearson. So it's by a different publisher than what they are recommending. The teacher found that with the Cengage, the one that they are recommending, they just enjoyed this resource over the other one because it had problem-solving strategies throughout the entire book. It was like almost every lesson had some type of problem-solving strategy to help them either work through the problem or to help them prepare for the AP assessments. It also has tips throughout all of the reading on maybe how to help them through a problem or maybe just a certain concept, just to give them a little hint on it. It was very detailed. It was visually pleasing to look at. There was more colors in it. The graphics were better. They were more up to date than what they were in the other one. It does also have the online platform, which is really nice. It has AP supports on the online platform that the kids can go to and they can just practice for the AP test. It has the interactive videos that students can do online. They can watch different application problems that they can work through, almost like a lab at that point, those types of applications. And the nice, really nice part about the online program was that it had like this personal study plan for students. So it was like this little, I kind of picture it as like this little study hall that they could go to, this little room that they could go to and either prepare for the AP test. They had quizzes that were available. They had practice exams that they could do. They had videos that they could watch, but also it was geared towards not only the AP, but even the units that they were learning about throughout the entire test. So these could be practice quizzes that students could do before an assessment to get them ready for it. None of that has to be pushed out by the teacher. It was only at the student's pace that they could do it, which I thought that was really a really nice feature to it. So nothing was graded, nothing was required. It's just a place that students can go for resources. So their recommendation would be for each student to have a textbook, because this is physics 1 and 2, so it is two separate classes. And so they are recommending a one-on-one textbook for each student and a digital access for the student and the teacher. Any questions? Oh, and by the way, let me go back. This is the one where it says 2018. This is the company that said, hey, we have another one that is coming out. And it will be at the warehouse in January. We are happy to swap them out. So this is the publisher.
I use their marketing books. I got my old ones that are stacked up to hold my computer monitor. I got number one, number two, number three units.
Yes.
Yeah. Which is good. Like it's, when I say the revenue piece, but it's also contemporary. You know, the fundamental principle that might be in there, but whenever they update things, they try to bring in a newsworthy, real example, at least in the business end of what Cengage publishes. They're always very up to date with their stuff.
Mm-hmm. Chris, I noticed that this was the only of the three so far where you identified this as one-to-one textbook for students. And I suppose I would have assumed that they were one-to-one textbooks. Were the others just a classroom set?
Yes, they were classroom sets. Yep.
And then the last one is social studies. The one that we are bringing to you today is AP government. So for the AP government review, we had three teachers, one from each of the three high schools. So it was, again, a smaller group, but we went through the same process that we would have for anybody else. So for this one, their current textbook is the American Government Institutes and Policies, and it was 2017 by Cengage. They are recommending The Stories of a Nation, which is by Bedford, Freeman, and Worth, and this is the first edition of it. It is brand new, 2021. Some things that they liked about this, and I thought the first was pretty cool, that it's written by an actual AP teacher. So it's somebody that is on the College Board site and had a lot of input with the College Board. So that gave them a lot of credibility, and they really liked that piece of it because it was written with a teacher lens. And so they found that students kind of benefited from that as well. A couple of other nice things about the text. One, it starts off, every single unit starts off with a story that's from the real world. So it starts with engaging them right away with some kind of story of government and, I'll just end it there. but then gives like practical applications to kind of guide it throughout the entire unit. So it just brings it right along. It also integrates skill into the text. It has its own little public policy book that comes along with it to talk about public policy. It also has critical thinking assignments, which was different from the institutes and policies. So that was another important piece to them, is that critical thinking piece. It also offers the AP practice, like most of them do, with practice exams. And the online platform for this one, it just far exceeded that of Cengage, just with different components of it. It had a similar type of kind of study corner that was there before. It also has what's called Launchpad, which is an adaptive quizzing, which was really cool to watch. So it's similar to ISL, where it would, if they're probably wrong, it would kind of bring you back to a certain set of problems, and then you could kind of move forward at your own pace, which was really awesome. So their recommendation would be one-to-one textbook as well, so not a classroom set, but one-to-one, and then digital access for students.
One quick question is all, on the agenda it says that the first edition was 2019 and the bear says 2021. Just curious which is correct?
I believe it's 2019.
Oh, it's the newer edition. So sorry, yes. So this one, they did update this one already. So see how it says presidential election updates? So the 2019 did not have that presidential election update on it. So we were just going back and forth with a publisher, and yes, we would like to move forward with a purchase order, and they were like, hey, we have this new updated one. We're like, perfect timing. So that's the difference.
Do you have copies of this one that we can?
Yes, I have copies of all of them. Yep. And we
have online access.
Yes.
Okay, so you can read that.
Yes. Yes, the government one is right there. Okay. Crush all the box. Any other questions? Yeah. So then I just want to give a little shout out to my AP social studies teachers to help with this process. They did a great job. It was wonderful to work with them. Thank you, and thank you guys for listening to our recommendations. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chris.
Yeah.
I hope that you were able to just sort of hear a little bit about the process that goes in. It's not just a sit down and, oh, it looks good today. There's a lot of hard work that goes into this, and Chris has really established herself as a person that runs a great process and has learned a lot this year. So Chris, thank you so much for leading teachers in this and really helping them along make the best decisions for our students. So we really appreciate that. So thank you. You can have back into the agenda, I did hop over, there is a review of the request for board approval of a supplemental resource, and that's Chains, the Seeds of America, Seeds of America Church. And there's a presentation for that supplemental material, but just wanted to make sure the board was aware of that. And that's coming out later.
Can I just ask though? So what grade is this going to be for?
If they're requesting it, Ada, fourth grade, as a read aloud.
As a read aloud to go, okay, is it, I'm just wondering, I mean, this is not a topic that is fourth grade standards for social studies. So is it a read aloud as a part of like a historical fiction?
Yes, it's part of the reading history of the American Revolution. So they're asking to help support. So there are a lot of mentor texts that come with it, a lot of nonfiction texts.
Yeah.
And they're asking for to be able to use it as a read aloud in conjunction on the American Revolution.
So it is a history. But why are they doing that in the Revolution Unit in fourth grade?
That is part of their reading if they're nonfiction.
Okay,
so they've been doing that. Yes.
It
is part of their reading.
Okay.
So not social studies, but reading.
Okay.
It's a nonfiction unit, and so they pull in and have, you know, that's kind of the overarching topic of the unit, and that's where they're asking to have this be part of that unit.
Okay. So I think this is an amazing book, and my kid is going to for sure read it. I can't put it down. There are some harder scenes, and I don't think that they're gratuitous by any means, but they're tough, and I feel like fourth grade, I don't know. I mean, I'm just curious, it's a read aloud, so is there a lot of instruction and conversation around those?
There is. That's the beauty of a read-aloud.
Yeah.
You're sitting with you and reading that. I do commend the Ada team, too, for coming to you, too, for your guidance, how would you feel about this.
Yeah.
But I do know, like, many of the fourth graders have read it. They've read it in the past.
Yeah.
The teachers.
Like, I think it's amazing. I love it. And I'm going to read the next two as well. I just would not want some of it glossed over.
No. They read it like in the entirety of the unit as well, so it's read very slowly. I mean, when you're reading nonfiction, even one of the skills, even in fourth grade, is to reread. So there are the chapters that they read even more than once to demonstrate skills in the reading unit. So I know they're very intentional on how they deliver this.
Yeah.
The connection to the standards and what they're doing with this book.
Okay.
Kim, during those read alouds, are there times where teachers are intentionally skipping some sections too?
Yes.
So and I don't even know that I would say like that.
Right.
Would be something that I would necessarily want. I think that when I had a fourth grader, I mean, I wouldn't have had a big objection to them reading this book. I just would hate for some of these to be just glossed over and act like it was no big deal and just part of my read aloud.
Right, you're really emphasizing the opposite of skipping something, but making sure it's understood at the ending.
Yeah, or it's just like it's not flip, right? It's not flippantly. I mean, there's a scene, where there's a husband, punches his wife in the face, and I don't think it's well done. I don't think it's gratuitous, but it's obviously like a reason that household is why it is what it is. So I don't know. I just think there's some things that maybe could be a little bit triggery for some kids, and so I just wouldn't want those things to be just casually read.
So one thing we've done in the past, and with another book too, is if it is a recommendation, we can also offer recommendations on our sheet of like if this is going to be used, here are some key points we want to ensure they happen. Mm-hmm. So that's something too that we've done in the past and for high school class. We could do that too, like guidance for a teacher if it were going to be used. In their read alouds, it's read aloud too, so the students don't have individually have copies.
And that's good too because there's also some really old English words in it that I think would be hard for a lot of kids to understand. I mean, just because we don't even speak that way anymore. So, but I mean, I think it's truly an amazing book.
I did bring an extra copy.
I know, I was thinking, I did not get this copy.
Yes, so here it is. I did confirm, I told the test that I
Last thing I'd like to bring up in front of you is board policy surrounding, proposed board policy surrounding what we're just calling instruction, it's board policy 5407, instructional program and curricular development. Really, it is the book, or it was called the material reconsideration guide and process. So the board policy is there. We received that from Troon. Also, in your packet is the administrative guidelines that would accompany that if the board were to approve this policy. I can walk through this with you, a little sort of a high level overview, or the reflection items right with it. But essentially, there are steps to the process. If there is an objection by a parent on a particular book or instructional material, that process starts out with the teacher. It really, if we're not able to come to some type of understanding, then that goes to the principal. Again, there is discussion that takes place. There is, at that point, there is a request. There's actual a form that would be available for people to write those concerns down, so we're able to track that. And if we were not able to sort of figure out a way to make the situation amendable for the parent, in other words, is there an opportunity to provide choice with the book? That would be something that would be a reasonable outcome. Then the complainant could take the request to my office, where we would convene a committee, and we would have a committee take a look at that that particular material. There are four outcomes from the committee recommendation. One would be to retain the book. Another would be to move the book to a different level. So for example, if the book were at the middle school, one of the recommendations might be to move that particular book to the high school. A third option would be to require parent permission for students to have access to a particular book. With our follow-up system, we can sort of put that designation there that this particular book, if we're in the media center, would require parent permission. And then the last option would be to remove a book. The committee, the reconsideration committee, would be making a recommendation to board curriculum, to this board, this body here, and board curriculum would be the final say into how, really what happens with that particular book that's being considered. So that's it in a nutshell. All of the sort of the timelines and things are contained in this particular document. This document will be made available to the public. It will be on our website. So if people had concerns, they would have not only the ability to read the board policy, which would be embedded in the rest of our policies from Troon, but then also this would be an accessible link for parents to follow. And we would ask that parents follow that process and it's laid out for everyone to see.
When you mentioned this to us yesterday, we were talking about the different books. Can you just clarify that the process is the same or different if this is a book that's on a teacher's shelf versus a library?
Yeah, so there is if you go into the form where it says request for reconsideration, this mm-hmm. one here, it'll say if it's a request for reconsideration of a book, please skip to section 2, and if it's instructional material. So if it's within if it's a media center book, mm-hmm. you don't need to address a teacher with mm-hmm. that. That will be a conversation with the principal, and then the principal would let me know, and we would take a look at assembling a reconsideration committee mm-hmm. to take a look at how do we want to move forward with this. We also want to be able to address the concerns that a parent might have, and hear those out and better understand what that is. And so that's why we ask that this form is filled out, so we understand exactly what the issue is that we're dealing with.
So a question I might have is if somebody were to request, say, 200 of these things and submit them, that you have a plan in place for how much time that's going to take to go through the reconsideration process for all of those books. I mean, if you were to receive something like that, I could fairly assume the complainant probably hasn't read the entire book, if there was a submission of so many books. But say that they have, say that there are 200 of these things. How is there the manpower to manage that? Or are you just hoping or assuming that they probably wouldn't be this situation?
It's a great question. And it's one that many districts are grappling with. And the short answer is we don't have the manpower to do 200 book reconsideration requests. We will get through them as quickly as we can, knowing that each book deserves our full attention. So we're not going to hurry it. We're going to take our time, and we're going to make decisions that are, I'm going to decide, we're going to make recommendations in the best interest of our students, knowing that there's a lot of opinions out there. I also want to just put in front of the this committee as well that Bourdon College issued a statement, and Kristen, I'm sure you're very well aware of that, for AP designation. That,
right.
Basically, what they said is be careful, because if you are in the habit of sort of getting rid of lots of books, that can have implications. They didn't exactly say what those were, or what those, you know, like what books they were, but it was sort of a position statement, and we're looking at that, we're asking more questions. They did not clarify what that means, but it was interesting that it was on their website.
I mean, I think I love the work that you did with a group of people. You didn't come up with this all on your own. No, that going through this process, and it really almost, I would say, I don't know if the right word is codifies, or it documents what over my years of my kids being here, it articulates out what we would want to have happen, or like what he was saying today is, hey, when your student has something going on, the first person that the student should go to is their teacher. That's starting right there and figuring out what's going on with this particular assignment, whatever is happening right there at the source. Because that's, I'm assuming, that's the first place that you would go to. As I would be the last person somebody should ask about what somebody did in an English class. You would pick up the phone and go and want to talk to the teacher. So I think this helps parents understand, well, what do I do if I am unsure about something? Start here. But it also makes them recognize there is a process, that it's not just over and done with, that if they're not satisfied, there is a route and a process.
There is. Another thing that this doesn't contain, but I just want the board to know, is that our teachers have really worked tirelessly to be more transparent with the books that are being read. The last thing that we wanted to do was surprise a parent. And so we are working, and we've learned from mistakes, or we learned from the past, and we really are, there is a concerted effort to make sure that we put those books out in front of people so they know what their children are reading. We know that not everybody can agree on what's appropriate and what's not appropriate, but we desire to provide as many choices as possible for our families.
Well, yeah, one question I had here is, of course, when we look at what do you do with this book, and require parent permission prior to student access before remove the book as an option. Requiring parent permission, will the district or has the district compiled a list already that we will now consider to be require parent permission? Or are we going to wait on parents to first bring forth a book reconsideration form?
We haven't gone there yet. I think that there a website exists where there are some concerns around the book, and we know of some books that you can just Google, right? Which books are most challenged in the school district? I mean, you can Google the list without even reading the books. And so to answer that question, we haven't put a lot of thought into how do we go back and take care of some books that may have objections.
Well, and I'm thinking specifically of classroom libraries anyway, because the books themselves for classrooms, as long as I've been teaching and before that, you can easily go through a process to replace, a book you don't mind child
sure.
reading. But yeah, it's the classroom libraries that I think have been drawing the attention.
And we have seen in conversations with conversations with other districts where now parent permission is required to have access to a classroom library.
So the entire library.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's something we need to do more in talking about what the rationale is, why we've seen a greater emergence of classroom libraries, that we want students reading all the time. We're trying to develop that habit of daily reading, and that's the why of what it is that we're trying to develop. There's certainly a wide array of things to try to capture the interest of students. As I mentioned before, my younger daughter right now is just everything tigers. So anything that has the animal, not the sports team, but anything that has to do with the animal, she wants to read. Well, again, you can begin to think of the potential topics that exist out there that go sort of far and wide. But you know, she's bringing home all sorts of things related to that topic, and we're trying to say, oh, there's other things to read about too. Yes, so I think it's important to have the why out there. And as Scott said, what we don't want to do is to create situations that are surprising parents or eroding the partnership between the school and the teacher and the parents at home.
Mm-hmm. Okay, moving down the agenda under action items, the minutes from February 16th, as well as the recommendations for chains, monthly review of the books, really all the books that Chris presented. And that is my report, and Dan, I will
sure. Just a little update on a topic we don't talk about that often, but it's getting lots more attention, and that's the topic of cybersecurity. One of the reasons why we're replacing 3,747 Chromebooks is because sometimes devices get to a certain age where the manufacturer or the software provider will no longer support them, and what that support means is they're no longer putting out automated updates of the software for security patches and things like that. Oftentimes we don't see this because when we turn on a computer, every once in a while it may take a little longer to boot up. Often what's happening is they're doing automated updates where they're updating the software with some sort of patch in the background so that it's going to be more secure when some new threat is exposed somewhere globally. So device manufacturers are doing this all the time. But after a certain point in time, they say, hey, that device 4732 that we manufactured 6 years ago, we're no longer going to do security updates on that device. And that's when they really become vulnerable. Insurance carriers for schools have put in more and more requirements in order for us to have coverage for a breach in cybersecurity. So there's more things that we're having to do on both the technical side of the house as well as, I'll just call it the human behavior side. And sort of the shorthand on human behavior is be careful which stuff you click on, especially those hyperlinks or emails you may not recognize or things like that. So we're doing more and more in that space. Schools, hospitals, other sort of institutions that exist that are thought to have some value economically, but may not have the horsepower to put in a big cybersecurity team, those are becoming the targets of kind of the global cybersecurity threats that are out there. And they truly are global in that regard. So there's a lot more that we're doing. I don't talk about all those things publicly for security reasons on that, but we are having our employees, all of us, yours truly, where you're sort of prompted as you log into your device, hey, there's a cybersecurity training that you'll need to do. It's gonna take you 14 minutes to complete it. Would you like to do it now? Okay, you're saying no. All right, you've got 8 more opportunities to say no before at some point you're no longer gonna say, be able to say no in order to get into your device. So we have more and more of those trainings that are going. Again, a lot of it comes through from insurance carriers as well. And certainly insurance deductibles and premiums are going up on this issue.
Is that happening on teacher and students machines?
Certainly happens on all staff machines, so teachers as well will be on that. For students, so students are locked down a little bit more as to what it is they can access, so we have greater controls on the student side at the front end filtering. So we filter both internally in the district as well as through the ISBs, since we pull our internet pipe through there now. Is that right, Julie, or we're about to? I'm trying to remember that piece. We haven't flipped just yet, but we will, so they've got filtering on that end as well. And I should say, I work with the collaborator, I chair the collaboration committee of superintendents, and we talk about these type of issues and say, all right, if we're all having to do some cybersecurity things to keep our insurance certificates up to date, can we do that collaboratively so we aren't all out there, you know, creating a deal on our own and maybe getting some better breaks on the training programs that we go through and those type of things on that. And the ISD is helping with some of these things. They've brought on a couple more people that just focus solely on cybersecurity. I remember, this is, gosh, maybe a decade ago, I think it was before Susan joined us, our previous technology director, he just mentioned, you know, of the emails that come into the district in a given day, more than 90% are filtered out by our security filter as just bogus. And I said, you know, how many come into the day? At that point, it was well over 100,000 in a day. And I'm sure that was a decade ago. I'm sure it's higher now on that. So just an important issue that, like I say, we don't talk a whole lot about, but just to know the things that we're doing with that. The state budget process continues to move forward. The governor released her budget proposal. We are now probably here in March that we'll see proposals for the school aid budget come from both the Senate and House Appropriations Committees for school aid. And one of the things just to update on the state budget is that we had an updated revenue estimating conference in January where they came to consensus on what the revenue estimates are for each month from now all the way through the end of the fiscal year for the state, which is in September. And we're exceeding even the January estimates. Revenues are coming in higher on that. And that's not necessarily a surprise as you think of what's going on, as you think of sales taxes, income taxes, property taxes. There's other taxes that are out there, but all of those things are generating more revenue. So we're at a Lansing. The debate is, the governor's proposal has quite a bit of dollars in the school aid fund devoted to teacher recruitment and teacher retention on that. And I think we'll see proposals from the House and the Senate that will take a good chunk of that money and push it elsewhere. Wouldn't be surprised if it's on the foundational elements, but we'll see as that comes through. And I also wouldn't be surprised to see it on that still remaining unfunded liability portion in the retirement system. Those liabilities have been shored up considerably with changes to that plan. And they also are shored up when there's better market returns. There's a big, huge block of assets that there's a large state person, a large state team that invests all those in, and those investments have beat the projections that are made in the retirement system. I think the projections are a rate of return, Julie, is around 7%. Is that what, I can't remember those exact things that they have on that, but they certainly have exceeded. Yeah, I'm trying to remember. I might be confusing that with something else.
Adjusting
it
downward?
They have been adjusting it downward. So that reduces the unfunded liability when they adjust it downward and they can keep at that. But they've exceeded that mark. The other things that they look at for that retirement system rate is estimating what aggregate payroll is, because the retirement system is funded as a percentage of payroll. So they have to look at payroll in the state and see where that is. And then finally, it's the number of active employees paying in. Is everyone's required to pay in? And the number of people drawing out on that. And then also the actuarial performance of how many people passed away that are no longer drawing. So it's not unlike other defined benefit programs, even like Social Security. So we could see some more money being proposed to pull down that long-term unfunded liability. An ESSER update. We, was it yesterday, Julie, that the state came out with
the
plan, so
yeah,
maybe
so
it hasn't come yet. I haven't seen it.
They sent an email out by you.
haven't seen that either. So we are awaiting Michigan Department of Education releasing the materials that we need to apply for the ESSER $3. So we know what the allocation is. We just haven't even received the application material saying, here's how we want to use that. Once we receive that notice, we have 90 days to complete that. So we're continuing to move along with that. Again, just some highlights of where we're focusing in on the use of those dollars. After school programming, we know that some kids, to address learning loss and gaps that exist, need more time. And a way to find more time is with after school programming. That won't meet everyone's needs, but we know we've got to set aside some dollars for that as well. Summer programming is another piece that we're looking at for addressing those academic learning loss needs as well that are out there. So we'll have proposals in both of those areas. Kindergarten first grade surge aids. Those have been successful for us. We've used ESSER $2 with that, and we would look to continue that with ESSER 3. Again, the thinking here is that students in that group, many of them may not have had typical either preschool experiences or early childhood experiences that are important milestones on that. And to have additional set of hands at those age levels can help kids make up some of those gaps. And we know from research that the younger you intervene with a child in any of those gaps, the more successful and the more efficient economically. Even if you have gaps that you don't address and you wait for 5 years, it's a lot more costly and a lot less effective at that point in time. So those kindergarten surge aids, in many ways, is they free the teacher to stay focused on those high leverage activities and instruction and like. Without them, a teacher can get sidetracked into, I lost my boot, it's time to go out, you know, or I can't get my coat off, or the zipper isn't, I mean, things like that, that, and just, you've seen this with your own children, if you remember back to that time, it can take a lot of extra time. We don't want that bleeding into instruction. That's not the only thing you're doing, but I'm just trying to give some examples of how all that can cascade in the wrong direction when we don't have that support, and can move us in the right direction. That's been something our early elementary teachers have really appreciated. Special education, as we think of students with disabilities, this is also a population where the gaps from the pandemic, in some cases, have been more pronounced. So this will help us with additional teacher support in our resource rooms as well. Our resource room teachers are wanting to understand much better what's happening in the gen ed classroom so they can support that work in reading, in literacy, in math. And so there's more professional learning that we can provide to our resource room teachers on that and bring those sources of support there. Scott and I have been going around at spring visits with principals, and one of the things we've been hearing as we've been talking with our secondary level principals, middle and high school, is more focus and help with math. So math obviously becomes more complex, but there's a need for more time for teachers to spend with students that may have some gaps or may have a need just for another go at that lesson or taught in a different way. So we've been thinking, how can we do this? After school is certainly one way, and we're starting to see after school math support during lunch, math support cropping up, and those things are great. But we're also looking at some of our schools will have an additional hour where students will go for additional math support. Or again, maybe something that happens after school with the actual math teacher you have during the school day. It may not be every day of the week, but there are times that we can schedule that in. So that's a need that we also want to address and are looking for extra dollars to help with those pieces as well. You know, these are one-time dollars, so the trick is to try to find ways to certainly address the needs that current students may have, but also to use the dollars in such a way that they have a longer-term impact. So looking at those dollars for increasing just the capacity of our teachers, additional professional learning, whether it's how do we make the best use of an online resource, how do we deal with any of these various issues that we've been talking about, oftentimes if we can equip the teacher, instead of just handing some students some fish, teach the teachers how to fish for those particular things on that. So professional learning is another piece that we're looking at that. K-1, also looking at literacy on this with decodable books. So as we work more with students on just milestones on that, just that phonics-based decoding that students, it's basically how much time you spend in that area, it's really can make a difference on that. So more of those resources we've heard from our early elementary teachers will make a difference on that. We know that the best type of professional learning is job-embedded professional learning. So instead of me leaving the classroom and going to some, I don't know, auditorium or some art room or a Zoom session or whatever, if someone can push in and is right there alongside and can see exactly what I'm seeing with students on that and then can come alongside as a coach on that, that makes a huge difference. So we're looking at bringing that level of coaching to our secondary level. Right now, we're more intensive at the elementary level with that classroom-based coaching that we push right in. And teaching can be a complex set of tasks, and as you have students with multiple needs, sometimes it's just helpful to have another set of eyes on that. We see other professional students, right? You can, you know, see a physician and say, well, I want to consult with a specialist. I think it's this, but I'm not sure, and let me bring a second opinion in on this. So that can help as well. So that's another piece that we're looking at. And then again, those tier two supports, as we think of tier one, that's the instruction we're providing to all students, but sometimes students need more. So how do we provide that tier two level of support? Not only the academic side, but also the behavioral side. We know, especially with younger children, their communicating needs sometimes through behaviors. They don't have the words to say, here's how I'm feeling, but that need is being communicated through behavior. And so how do we better understand what the function of that behavior is and then help to redirect that student to more appropriate behaviors that are going to appropriately satisfy an unmet need that is there, and then also helping teachers understand what those things are as well. Last school year, we saw a record low number of behavioral issues in our schools, especially at the elementary level. I checked with other districts, they saw the same thing. What's frustrating is we don't have a great answer as to why that was the case, but what also seems to be more universal this year is a lot more refusal behavior. So you'll have a first grader who say, no, I'm not doing that. And where does that come from? And trying to understand that better. And those can be really disruptive in the classroom as we're trying to, again, deal with that behavior, meet the needs of the other students, and also, you know, it's a re-regulation of the behavior as well. So those are pieces that we're seeing on that. So those tier two supports are both in the behavioral space and the academic space. We're not finalized on this, but and this isn't a complete list, but I wanted to give you an update at least as to the types of things that we're thinking about and where our conversations have been on that. We're also looking at the piece around counseling. Christine Yelman's been doing a deeper dive into our whole system, not only with counselors, but social workers and all of that system. And what we want to do is to make sure that we're making obvious systemic improvements before we just say, oh, let's just add people to a system that may not be performing at a level that we all want it to perform at. So we'll be meeting with her very shortly next week to kind of get an interim report on that. And I would also look to have Christine Yelling come to this committee, though, and just kind of talk through what things that she's seen and finding as well as we're going through and taking a deeper dive at all the systems. So I haven't listed those things in this ESSER update, but those are things that we have sort of a dot, dot, dot on as we hear from Christine as she's talked to all the stakeholders out in our system as to where possible system improvements can be. I just met with one of our social workers yesterday. She was talking about the inordinate time that is spent with paperwork and just not as much as she would love serving the needs of students. And I said, you know, give me an example of some of the things. And she was talking about some of the software frustrations. I said, you know, if you could wave a magic wand, I can't even remember the software she was talking about, but they come through the county. And she's like, you know, as I'm typing this and this, I would love it to just duplicate over on this other form that is required under the regulations. But I, every time I have to cut and copy and paste, thank goodness for cut, copy, and paste. But if they could just duplicate them. So that's a coding issue in the software. So it's finding just some of those things that can be, you know, reducing some pain points and making things a little bit more time efficient for folks doing that. So those are all things that we're looking at. And then just the other piece I want to update on our process for appointing a board member to the vacancy that we have. So Val is looking at application materials that come in to make sure they meet the eligibility criteria under the law. So then we've got that. And then what we look to do is to get those materials out to members of the board so they can begin reviewing those materials. The only time we can sort of discuss the applicants that come in would be at an open meeting of the board. So we're looking to schedule that as a special meeting. And then depending on the number of applicants, if the board were to look to narrow those applicants in the field in some way, that also happens in a meeting. And then if we wanted to go through an interview process on that, if that was something, we would look to schedule those pieces as well. A piece we want to be mindful of are any applicants that come in and apply, and then sort of the quick turnaround it would be if we go to an interview process and having to move quickly into that process as well. This is a rapid timeline under state law, and we need to have everything done by the close of business on Tuesday the 29th, but we're scheduled at this point to try to meet the deadline by Thursday the 24th. So that gives us some ample additional time in case a blizzard hits. I don't see anything on the forecast or anything like that. But that's where we'll be with that process. That's all I have on my list. Scott, anything else you've done? Julie, anything else from your world?
Just a quick clarification from the educational meeting conference. If we get for the equalization, the formula is already out. We've been following the due dates for that,
mm-hmm.
for the different components of that.
Yeah, the equalization button's the bigger one.
Yeah, that's one.
Christina, anything else? Yeah. Just a little quick bond update. We've got some turnovers of phases in a couple of our buildings scheduled for spring break. And good news, we're pretty well ahead of schedule on those things, so that allows us to have maybe a less frenetic spring break on turning over some of those new spaces that are available, and then also kind of putting up those temporary partitions for the next phases and buildings that we go to do the renovation. So Orchard View's got some coming up, Collins has some coming up as well. Thornham, thank you, Thornham. Exciting stuff on this. That's everything. All right.
Well, thank you, everybody.
Appreciate it. Yeah, enjoy the.